to my house on videotape them, and then people would come to my house and we would have watched these videotapes. Well, this is what you do with your arm, you do with this, and that's the way we learn how. And then eventually we went up to Toronto for a couple of lessons. But basically, we started from scratch with not a harp on the island. There's now over 36 harps on the island, and 30 of those are being quite active, so we're quite pleased. So without further ado this evening, welcome to the amazing world of the ancient harp. This is one of the oldest instruments in the world. It's mentioned in the Bible way, way back. And to avoid confusion, I'm going to begin by defining the difference between the lyre and other string instruments and the harp. And the main difference is this. The harp has the strings coming out of the soundboard at an angle coming up toward an arm or an R at the top. This leaves the strings open on both sides. The lyre, on the other hand, comes across the soundboard over a bridge and fastens to a bar at the top, as does everything with a zither or a dulcimer or a violin or a viola chop. All other string instruments go flat to the soundboard. The harp is the only one where the strings are open on either side. On all of these instruments, you play near one end of the string. Like on the fiddle, you play near one end of the string. On the piano, with the hammers hit near one end of the string. In the harp, you play in the middle, and the strings vibrate freely. So you'll have a beautiful tone, an entirely different tone on the harp than any other string instrument. And I've given out handouts so that you can see these pictures and know exactly the difference between the two. We're going to explain the difference as they came down and as they developed, starting there. So to begin with, I'm going to go back to page one. Thank you. And we're going to start with some of the earliest recognized writings about the string instrument, or the lyre. The lyre, in reality, is the ancestor of our harp. And it was mentioned in Sumerian writings, 2800 BC, and if you look at it, it's a box with two arms and a crossbar at the top. And the strings, again, ran across with the sound box and up to the top. The Egyptians did somewhat similar. If you look at the picture on your diagram, you'll see that the Sumerians held it out in front of them like this, where the Egyptians turned it inside out. So instead of holding it up like this, the Egyptians held it like that. But basically, it was the same style of harp or lyre. The Greeks, who came quite a bit later, made round bodies, and the mythology says, I believe if we look back in history, that Greeks of Hermes made the first lyre from a tortoise shell. Actually, if you look on the next page two and look at the African lyres, that's exactly what they look like today. They haven't changed in 4,000 years. They're still using that same type of instrument. Now, it got a little more elaborate and looked more like this as time went on, as you can see in the picture of a lady playing it there on her lap. And then the Romans came along, and they put more in a square box. Looks a little more square. But we have writings that said that, that Nero not only fiddled while Rome burned, but he also played the lyre. So that these are some of the earliest versions that we have records of, either a picture or a carving or some type of record of what these instruments looked like. A lot of them were down from the Greeks and the Egyptians. They put them into stones and carved them on the wall so that we know exactly what these things looked like. All right, going along here, we have the next page. We have two instruments that developed in Europe and around in Asia and Africa. The guitar, it was a more sophisticated instrument with a box-shaped sound box, and it was made of wood. It had seven strings, and it was tuned by tension. That means each string was pulled a little bit tighter than the last one to change the sound. It had no tuning pegs as such to change them. And their length was all the same length. They were popular in Greece, where Apollo and Orpheus played them, and it was a symbol of harmony in their culture. Later in Rome, it was said that Mark Anthony also played, and if you look at it and look at them today, our modern auto harp looks very, very much like this crowth, which came down to us from the guitar and the crowth. And an auto harp that we have here today looks like this, and it's not too far down the line from what it was there. And this is an auto harp, which means you have the strings, you play the strings, and you put down bars to make them make different chords. So if you want to play a song, play along here. Thank you. So the, these dulcimers are still available today, Silver's Music Store. So, and they're not too far from what we have here. Now, as we go along, we have three basic forms of the harp. And they are the bow, or one continuous curved piece, which are shown in many, many places on the Egyptians and the Roman walls. Then you have the angle, which is a box thing with no crossbar here. And then you have the frame, or pillar harp, from which our harp has descended. So as you look at these, this one, of course, is the oldest one. And one second here. The lyre, which was plucked, now switches to the harp, which is plucked. And we're going to go now and leave the lyre, which developed, and go along with it. But we're going to stick with the harp. And we'll trace the development of the plucked harp. There's three basic forms. And if you look at the first regarding the ancient arch harp, this was known in Sumerian Egypt as early as 3000 BC. Two of its notable features are its size and its lack of a front pillar. And because of that, that suggests it was probably very loosely strung with quite a low tone, possibly, and likely sounded just in a very bass range. It stood upright on the floor, and the players either stood beside it or knelt beside it, as you can see in your pictures there, if you look on page 4 in your copies. Egypt can be considered the largest harp culture of all times. There were more harps and more use of harps in Egypt than any other country of the world. Harps existed from the Old Kingdom, which goes 3000 BC, right on up through and well into the Greek and Roman era. This shovel type B was called a Bennett, and it was very commonly used. And when I was shopping in Florida, there's a big Greek community there, and they had these little vases with pictures of the bow harp and of this one. So I'm going to pass it around and let you look at it to see that that's actually the types of things the Greek people were playing. So I'll start here, and you can pass it along back and see what they look like, because that's exactly what they were using. It's one of the oldest instruments that we have. And so moving on from the Greeks, then we go to the second type, which is the angle, or we call it the trigon, which was a later development. And it probably originated in Persia, and it was known in Egypt as well. And this is a picture in your copy, the angle harp. And this particular angle harp is pictured, it's in the Louvre in Paris, and is dating from the 1500 BC. It's probably the oldest harp that we have so far discovered. That is not a picture of a harp. This is a picture of an actual harp that they have in the Louvre. And it stands about 40 inches high, has 21 strings stretched between the vertical neck and the sound box. And again, the sound box now is up here, which is similar to our sound boxes, which are up at this harp and attached to the horizontal sound box. It was common in Greece, and its name in Greek is merely the word for triangle, or trigon, which is like their ships, the trigon ships, with the triangle sail that they had. It was called trigon ships. So that instrument is still used a bit in Africa and some of those countries, but it has really gone out of use in most of the other countries. Now we come to the frame, where they actually put a front pillar in. And this third type, which is really the ancestor of our present day harp. Can you see, Pastor, do you have a copy of the pictures? Oh yeah, okay, good. The earliest medieval frame harps were small, very sturdy, not too very fancy decorated or very many refinements. And if we look back, this Quota Anglica is one of the oldest existing harps that we have today from around the 1300s. We have the Brian Boru harp. Brian Boru was a ruler, and harpists were considered very high in rank, next to royalty. And they were paid with cows. To own cows, you were very wealthy. And the word for a bovine, bow, and he was Brian, or the cow owner, the harp player, so he was very wealthy. And And his harps are quite nicely done. And that is the style that we use today. Look at that picture, and you look at this one here from that belongs to the Irish Society. Very similar. These are plans that came from Ireland and was made here. And that's what they look like. They sometimes have like little shields on the front of them. It actually gives more strength to the front pillar. But these harps were the basis of what we have formed from today. And we've come down from that to a little more different style, which I'll explain again in a minute. This third type was one of the oldest surviving pillar harps, is the Queen Mary. Again, we have a harp. This is from the 1500s. And this is an existing harp. Now, there's some controversy is that maybe one piece of the wood was replaced. Oh, terrible thing, don't do that. One of my friends who is a harp maker, Jay Richard, who lives in Holton, Maine, and the reason he lives in Holton, Maine is because the best choice of wood that he can get is right across in New Brunswick. So he makes his hobby of going to Ireland, Wales, England, researching ancient writings or pictures, and then coming back and making these instruments. And he has made many, many copies of these instruments. And I have here pictures of his instruments that he's made. Beautiful pictures, and I'll let you come up and look at them afterwards. This is this one, he's made a copy of it. And this is the Trinity College one. And you can see this one has been beautifully inlaid and brass or copper added extra on so that you can come up and look at these pictures after. These are instruments that he has made researching. He's a sound vibration expert. He was working with the space program in the United States until they had computers that did what he did. And so he now uses his expertise of knowing that if this picture says this harp was 17 inches tall, he can figure out what the harmonic curve would have to be in order to make it play a scale properly. And that's what he does, and how big the wood should be. And so I'll let you look at some of those references. Sorry, not copies. Yes. Okay, now we come along to medieval harps. Very few instruments have lasted. If you take a look at the old sackbuts that are mentioned in the Bible, we don't have any of those today. We don't even have any pictures of those today. But we do have of the harp. And so we're going to come on down through and find out a little bit more in the form of stone carvings or pictures of triangular harps or medieval harps. They were small, sturdy, portable, because they were used by traveling musicians. The harp strings and material were expensive, and depending on where they were from, if you were in Wales, your harp was strung with hair. Horse hair, cow hair, whatever. If you were from Ireland, the strings were strung with brass. And if you were Scottish, they were with gut. So it depended what part of the world you were from. The harps in the other parts of the world at this time, however, we will focus on the British Isles mainly and stick with that particular area. And we call this the Gaelic or the Celtic harp. As certainly by the Middle Ages, the Celtic culture was well past its peak and became concentrated in the British Isles, France, and Brittany. So in these areas, the harp played a significant role throughout the Middle Ages. Harpers, or bards and their equivalents, were second in status only to royalty. And most of them, like Brian Boru, showed evidence of having been intricately carved and studded with precious stones and jewels. Then we come to, what is a Gaelic harp? All right, Gaelic harps are different. By the 11th century, a distinctive type of triangular frame harp had developed in Ireland and Scotland in the Highlands. And because its area of use coincided with the Gaelic language and the connection with the poetry that the poets sang along with, this Gaelic harp became the name Gaelic, the harp king, to call a Gaelic harp. And it's the national symbol of Ireland, which is the only country in the world that has the harp as its national symbol, not the shamrock. And it has still a very honored position in society today. It has a few differences from its counterparts or from any of these modern harps that you see on here today. For example, first, its strings were made of heavy brass. and it was plucked not with the finger fleshy part, but with fingernails, grown especially and cut especially to be able to play these brass strings. The sound box was made of one solid piece of wood, and usually it was willow, and hollowed out. The harp was situated on the left shoulder, and the left hand played the top part, and the right hand played the bass. So it was different from the way we do it today. So that's quite the thing. And the four pillar was very strong, T-shaped, and often had a little, sort of like a shield on the front of it. So that is a Gaelic harp. When you see a harp with brass strings, and it's played on the left shoulder, and it has a little shield on the front of it, then you know that's a Gaelic harp. And there's three distinctive styles of Gaelic harps. First, we have your small or 26 string harp, which is similar to that one up there. And it's a, what we call a low head harp. And it had brass strings, of course. The second one was a bit larger and still low headed. And if you look at this today, this is very similar to what we have here today. This is a low-headed harp. And instead of having brass strings, this has nylon strings. So it makes it much easier to play. This is a low-headed string. I'll leave these here, you can come up and look at them later. They're hollow on the inside, so they're not extremely heavy. But they're quite sturdy. And that's the low head. Then the next pipe was a high-headed one. And that's this one. And you can see quite a bit of difference in the shape of that. The more Gothic style. And some of the newer Gothic ones have even a curved back and are very thin, and they make a very delicate bell-like tone. And that's what these were. Only they made theirs with brass strings, and they did not sound good. All reports written in the records said not too good a sound. So this style didn't really catch on too far. They were much taller, longer, the neck had a sweep upward to meet the top pillar. It had up to 36 strings. Of course, we had to use these special fingernails, and they had to use a special damping technique, because once you play it, a brass string will keep ringing for a good 30 seconds. And so while you're trying to play all the rest of the song, this thing is still down here. So they have to stick a finger in and stop that one, and you're playing up here, and you stick a finger in and stop that. That's a whole different technique. And would you believe they're trying to bring this technique back? Yes, some people are playing it. Repertoires and skills at this time were passed on orally, and the harpists were highly regarded, and the patrons of the harpists, were, of course, were the Gaelic Irish aristocracy, and harpers received land, stock, cows, protection, and in return, they played for ceremonial, ritual, social obligations, and sang clan genealogies and clan praises, and laments and salutes. And if you went to a person's house and were their harp player for a month or so, you would write what we call plaintives, or thank yous. And chieftains were always wanting their stories told, and always like to hear their family history bragged about. And so we have plaintives. And I'm going to ask Christine to come up and play a couple of plaintives. Christine Galantis from Summerside, and she's going to play on a harp, and I'll ask Christine to introduce her pieces. Take down the chart.
Thank you. This one is called Carolyn's Welcome.
Types of music the harpers were played would be from quick to decide you were supposed to have three different styles if you were a concert or a Celtic Harper. You should be able to put people to sleep. You should be able to make them laugh and dance. Those were the three criteria that a harp player had to be able to do. Plaintive songs with strong contrast between bell-like sounds of the treble and the booming of the resonance of the bass were quite traditional, and they contained a lot of ornamentation, like Christine was putting in there, very little harmony, and very many subtle variations on the same tune going on and on and changing it a little bit each time. And of course, we have very little record of what any harmonies that they use. So we were left a little bit lacking there. The development and discouragements in the Irish harping tradition from the 14th century to the 20th century were many and varied. In the tradition that was constantly evolving and continues to evolve today, in many interesting ways, harp styles changed, as did the harp players and their music and their positions in society. Not much is known about the 14th century harpers, only other than the oldest complete Irish harp from that time is the Brian Bulroom harp. Similar ones. They resided in Trinity College in Dublin. They're sometimes called a cruet or a clarsach. And in the 16th century, the primary information available is about a few notable players of the time. There were the Scots brothers, John and Harry, who wrote apparently a lot of lamentations, but because it was all oral, we have no copy of the music. We know that Darby was a very famous harper, and he had to end up in Denmark because he couldn't get any jobs in Ireland. So he was there, and so did Cormac McDermott. He was a harper to Elizabeth I, and between the two of them, they wrote over 700 songs. We have no copies, because it's all done by ear, and music wasn't written down. Problems began, of course, as England usurped all the land and power from the Irish chieftains, and this actively worked to slowly destroy the Gaelic social fabric. Player to teach him, and at the end of 3 years, provided him with a broom, two horses, and harps, and set him off on his way. He became very famous and very popular. He is known for a tour down to Italy. He wrote a concerto, which really isn't a concerto, it's just a piece, but since all the pieces that were being written in Italy that time were concertos, technically his concerto was a solo for one instrument with an orchestra in the background, but of course when he got back home, he had no orchestra to go in the background and just play his concerto part. All right, we do have his music thanks to one thing, and that is we have at least 200 of his songs that are still kept, and a lot of them were flagsticks. And one of the reasons a lot of this music was kept was because they had a festival 1792 in Belfast, and also the tradition was not revived much by this festival. However, it was significant that it managed to preserve a lot of the harping traditions and songs because they hired one kid, Edward Bunting, 19-year-old church organist, and his job for the 4 days of this festival was to write down what they played. So of course he wrote down the tunes. He didn't get the harmonies. But there was one still traditional player at that festival. He was 97-year-old Dennis Hempson. He still played with the fingernails. He still played on the brass strings, and he gave volumes and volumes of information to Edward Bunting. And Edward Bunting published three sets of music, one in 1797, one in 1809, and one in 1840. And it's mainly from these books that we now have all of our traditional tunes, which were held then. There was another man at that time, Arthur O'Neill. He was the principal teacher in the Belfast Irish Society from 1808 to 1813, and he provided a lot of information also to Bunting, and Bunting included that in one of his publications. There was a remaining female itinerant harper at this time, Rose Mooney, and she was still going around and playing. But very few harpers still existed, and there were only 10 harpers at that Belfast festival. So that's how few were left at the time. So when you were asking if maybe some harpers came over from, I would say probably not. There probably wouldn't be too many left at that time. The Gaelic culture declined, and by the first half of the 19th century, all these hundreds of years of accumulated artistic excellence gone into silence. It just didn't seem quite right. I have to tell a little story. I'm born and brought up in Paradise, Nova Scotia, on an apple farm. And we used to hire pickers to come help pick our apples, and most of them were itinerant. Some of the French guys and some of the Indian people and some were various around. There was one little French guy. He wanted to have something to read, and so my father gave him the story of Evangeline. He'd sit in the corner with Stan. And when I look at this, that's what I have to say, I'm afraid. Because that's what's happened, unfortunately, to a lot of our society in the Celtic harp. We now come to then what is a Celtic harp? Because the Gaelic harps are the brass strum. And none of these harps that you see here are brass strum. These are all different. So around the 19th century, the Highland harp got out of use. It wasn't the best of tone. And we have what's called a Neo-Irish harp or a Celtic harp. It also goes by the name of folk harp or lever harp or Irish harp. So if you hear somebody say, I have a Celtic harp, or I have a folk harp, or I have a lever, it's all the same thing. It's these. And the reason that they're different is because they use gut or nylon strings, not brass. They use the soft part of the fingers to play, not nails. They put it on the right shoulder, and they play the right hand plays the treble and the left hand plays the bass. So that's the difference between the Gaelic and the Celtic harp. And the makers at that time made them both large and small. The small ones usually had better, and they had what we call levers. So if you look at a harp, this is what we call a lever, Celtic harp. This is Lynn McDonald's harp with this beautiful painting on the front. Isn't it a lovely harp? And these levers change. So you have a C. C's are red, M's are blue. So you can find your place on the harp, and if you want to have C sharp, you put the lever on, and you have a sharp. And so that's what changed. And the thing was, while the old Gaelic players were playing, and they were starting to go around, and as the chances for them to play got slimmer and slimmer, most of the people that they were playing for wanted the popular music of the time to play. And the Gaelic harp doesn't have levers, and they couldn't play the modern melodies. So therefore, this one was developed. And that's what we have today, these harps with levers that change. And so we have quite a change with that. And we still have the low head ones and the high head ones. They're exactly the same. And you can change the lever to get your different tones. And that's what we have. Come along a little further. Celtic harp, lever, folk harps, and we now come to multi-chorus harps. Not only do you have harps that have a single row of strings, we have harps that have a double, or triple, or cross-strung harps. That means this were the white notes, and these were the black notes. So if you want to play white notes, you play down here. If you want to play black notes, you play up here. And that's the way they got there without having any levers on. So that was sort of a in-between one until we got the lever harps. And the double-strung harps are two sets of strings. And without any further ado, I think I'll ask Jill to come up and do a little bit of explanation about her double-strung harp and play us a couple of pieces. This is Jill Harris from Murray Harbor, and we're very glad to have her this evening to demonstrate on her double-strung harp.
Well, I got this little baby last summer. I have to say, it was 2 years at the Irish Society. I think it was a couple of people from the United States by the name of Lauren Riley and Michael McKean. You recall that from the summer of 1995. They had come with the harps in the club. check, but when the moment comes, you know, I'm going to call.
Thank you.
Thank you.
the harps which were being developed for concert hall playing then had to be made a little bit bigger. And so by 1792, we're getting toward the end of 1700s, were greatly improved, and they, by the 1800s, you've strung with a single row of strings up to 46 or 47 strings, and were very tightly strung, and now because they were not with levers, they started putting what we call pedals, or a pedal harp, and the pedal harp that we have here is quite a bit different in how it changes. On the lever harp, you have what we call single action. You have a single lever which moves you up or down, playing sharp or flat. And on this one, you have what we call a double action harp. There are two sets of pins, one set here and one set immediately below on the same string. And so when you look at this harp, all the strings are in what we call A, B, C, D, E, F, G flat. They're on the black notes of pin. Then when I put the pedal down to the first bar, can you see the first one's changing here? Look at the red string. Can you see the red one changing? That now makes it from C flat to C. And when I put it into the second notch down, it goes to C sharp. So I have two possibilities, or three notes, on the one string. C flat, C, and C sharp. And not only does it change these with double action here, but there's rods that come up through inside here, and underneath here is an action like your finger. And when it moves this C, it also moves this one, this one, this one, this one, this one. So it's all C's changing at one time. So instead we have to reach up and go, chum, 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 chum. You have seven pedals, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. You have three notches for each one. And you have over 2,000 changes that you can do to get your possibilities for playing on the harp. It has a bigger tone and a fuller tone than a smaller harp. Not because of the strings, more strings, but because when you're playing up here, and I stop these, you can still hear it ringing down here. These strings are still ringing. So you get a fuller tone, even though I'm not playing on these strings down here, you get a fuller tone from the vibration, the sympathy vibrations that are going on down here. I'll give you a little bit of an example. I wish I could play it backwards round so that you can see, because I've chosen one that has a lot of pedal changes in it, so that you can hear the things changing to get your different pedal positions for sharps and flats, supposedly. This is by Saint-Saëns, the school one. Thank you. there talking about the Celtic harp. And we will conclude the program with that, and I hope that you enjoy the evening. We'll leave it with that.
Very brief little tune. Lance, I always think about you when I play this. A little Scottish tune called Katy Berry.
Workshop you wouldn't believe. Workshop. to see what you had.
I've done a nice job. Marvelous.
You have a security there.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
My question for all parts. Can we, were there cameras?
No, those are hammered dulcimers. They went from the other side. They went from the entrance.
Yes, did they ever be that part in the way?
No. Well, some of the new pieces that they play with orchestra, they have bells and cymbals, and yes, they hit their ring halfway up the string, and then they run a spoon up and down the they don't always play with the fingers, but basically, they're played as these are here today. Okay, without further ado, help yourself to something to eat. Please go and they come up and look at the instruments.
Thanks very much for coming, folks, and thanks to Joan and all the other harpers who are here tonight. It's a wonderful night. Yeah, let's have a hand. Have something to eat, and we'll see you next year.
Thank you. Because they all come back with that.
Thank you. It's wonderful for the time. What time? I don't say what time. And I didn't say it in the bottom. And I missed the first two, and they're probably the ones that would like this. But I like this one.
No, thanks. No.